The final test of a leader is that he leaves behind him in other men the conviction and the will to carry on. Walter Lippmann.
Chief Stover, it's truly an honor to be allowed on this recording, and I have a few memorable moments I recall from you. I had hoped for a teleprompter here, but Obama wouldn't give it up, so you'll have to bear with me looking at my notes. First time I met you was before I was on the department, and you were at my mom's place of business, and talking to her, she introduced me, and I knew the name, but didn't have anything to put with it. And then after you left, I learned how much my mom literally adored you. And I think that if she had the opportunity to trade me for you, she'd have done that, but couldn't do it. So I just went along with it. I'd just gotten out of the Navy, so I was way out from getting on the department. A few years later, when I finally got in here, you came out to the academy to see us. And, you walked in, walked to the front of the class, stared at us, and you said, "You are not at war with the community." And then you walked out the door. And for some reason that has stuck with me. At the end of the academy, we're walking the gauntlet through graduation. I got up to you and we began talking right there about my mom. And when you saw her out there in the audience, you gave her a shout and you said to her, "If this guy ever gets out of line, you let me know, I'll take care of it." And she says, "Same goes for you, Bob." Well, you made her day on that completely. There's been a few memorable press conferences I remember that you were in. And one that sticks out in my mind was an officer involved shooting on a subject that had a knife he had pulled on him. And there was a lot of dispute on the citizenry side without having all the facts. But you had gotten a press conference and you said, "If somebody pulls a knife on one of my officers and that officer doesn't shoot him, I'm going to shoot the officer." Then you walked away. And again, I loved it. That was excellent. I was up and you're near your office one time dropping something off, and I heard commotion coming from your door. And there was a reporter coming out with his tail between his legs. And you were saying very sternly that don't come back here. You are now banned from the police station. And then you looked at me in the same breath and says, "Hi, how's your mom doing?" And I don't know how you did it, but you made my day on that one. When you left the police department, you left some pretty big shoes to fill. And I don't ever think they've been filled completely. There have been some close, and there's been some others that were so far off they shouldn't have even been there. But I have nothing but admiration for you, Chief. And I completely understand why my mother thought so much of you. And I share her feelings as well. It has been my honor to not only work for you, but to know you as well. And I thank you for that opportunity. May God bless you.
Bob Stover, Jinx Jones here, sir. Class number 25, March of 1966. I just want to thank you for letting us chase crooks. We did a pretty damn good job, and we couldn't have done it without you. We knew that you had our back. We knew that you would take on the city council, the mayor, and the media, and that you had our back all the way down the line. I just want to say thank you for letting us do our job the way we should have done it. You are the chief's chief. We've all heard the expression cops cop, but you are the chief's chief, and I thank you for making us good policemen. Thank you, sir.
Hi, Chief. I'm Don Mayhew. You were one of the great leaders of our time. You were chief of police when I joined the police department in 1974. You had just taken over as chief. And you led the police department through some of the most tumultuous times in law enforcement. You were always a guide, a mentor, a leader, someone that we looked up to for leadership and guidance. We knew where you wanted to take the department, and you gave us the tools and the training to do it. Under your leadership, we had one of the best police academies in the United States. We had one of the first, one of the best crime labs in the United States. We were the first department to have Crime Stoppers in the United States. We were one of the first departments to have APHIS, automated fingerprinting, in the United States. One of the first departments to have DNA in the United States. You laid the groundwork for us to bring the International Association of Chiefs of Police to Albuquerque. You were just somebody who gave us what we needed to do our job. And I think that was one of the things that helped make the department great. You never minced words. You told it like it was. You supported us when we needed support, when we needed a good ass chewing. You brought us in, and we knew when we left that we'd had an ass chewing from Chief Stover. But we also knew what we needed to do to get back in the fold and to do the right thing. I always looked up to you as a great leader. I always looked up to you as someone to emulate and as a mentor. And for that, I owe a lot of my career to you. And for that, I appreciate it. Thanks, Chief.
This is Roy Dennis. Hi, Sheriff, Chief, Mr. Stover, Bob, the many names that you've gone by. I won't mention any of the aliases. I'd like to tell you that working for you was probably one of the brightest points of my career. You're the one that got me started, and I'll always appreciate that. I appreciated your humor, your straightforwardness, the fact that you never forgot where you came from. I'll never forget the story when you and your wife and my mom and dad were taking dance lessons at the Elks Lodge, and both couples came out and said, "Damn, now I can't dance anymore. I've got to relearn everything that I learned." I also will never forget you taking us all to Doris's snack bar and saying, "Okay, kids, belly up to the bar, I'm buying." You are greatly loved, not just by me, but by this community, not just law enforcement, everybody. I want you to know that. I think the last time I saw you was when I was running for sheriff in Santa Fe County. You never called me by my first name until that day. You always called me Kid. And that day you said, "Roy, have you lost your fucking mind?" To which I said, "Well, you ran twice." And your response was, "Nobody said I ever got any smarter." Wish you Godspeed, all the best, I'd love to see you.
Chief Stover, William Kurth here. I was but one of many officers you promoted over the years, and while your memory might be a little bit fuzzy, mine is not, you made a big impact on me, sir. Back in 1990, when you promoted me to sergeant, you brought me into your office, sat me down, and told me I needed to know a few things. Now, Chief, you were like a maestro when it came to using four-letter words, and I can't do you justice, but and decorum won't let me even try, so I'll go ahead and paraphrase for you. You told me that I needed to know a few things. You told me I didn't need a pole vault to jump over mouse droppings, not to mess with your officers, and they were your officers, we all were, sir. Most importantly, you reminded me that there was no such thing as a second-class citizen. Sage advice for a young rookie police sergeant. That advice and the example that you set served me well over my years, and it continues to serve me well today, even as a police chief of my own agency. Chief Stover, thank you for that advice and for your fine leadership example.
Hi, Chief Stover. I'm Ed Perea. We have spoken in the last few weeks. I'm sure you might remember me, the candidate for district attorney, former APD, joined APD in 1981 and retired in 2005. You recall the stories that we've shared. As a 14-year-old, I was elected as chief of police for the day, and you and I spent the day together, including a luncheon. You know, the words that we spoke, again, as a young 14-year-old, still stick with me today. Of course, during the time I spent with the department, you were chief of police for a period of time, and really admired and respected you for your leadership, strong leadership and strong role model. And it's something that stays with me today. And again, I appreciate it. personally and professionally. You were truly a role model. And it's always appreciated. So Chief, thank you, and I'm sure we'll continue to see you in the future.
Hi Chief, you'll always be Chief to me. My name is Bev, you know me well. One of my fondest memories, Bob, I have many, but one of them is the day that it was time for me to be promoted to sergeant. I got the call from up there in on the fifth floor and come see the chief. So I came up to see you and sat down. And that's really the first one-on-one I had had with you. I had seen you in briefing and around, but didn't really ever have a heart-to-heart with you. And that day, we had a heart-to-heart, and I have never forgotten that. I always called it the dad talk. You sat me down and you talked to me like I was your daughter. And you told me what it takes to be a great leader. And Bob, I certainly hope that I carried through with what you told me. I always tried my best to remember what you told me, because you're one of the greatest leaders I've ever known. You're the best chief ever. And they will never make another Bob Stover. When they made you, the old mold was broken. But I know there's gonna be rejoicing in heaven when you get there. I love you so much, Bob, and I will always think of you and the good times we had over the years celebrating our birthdays. I won't have a birthday again without you, and I'll always, always think about you, Bob. I love you.
Hi, my name is Ken Murphy. Bob, it's nice to see you again. I got a couple stories I wanna let everyone know about. My first one was when I went to work old Sector 3, which was like from Wyoming west to Girard and the freeway south. And about 1975, I started there like in the summer, and you used to drive up Lomas, and you'd be approaching Wyoming, and I'd be riding on my motorcycle, and next thing I know, I'd hear this car horn, and it'd be you, and you'd look at me, and you'd pull it over. Okay, Chief, I'll go ahead and do it, you know. And so we'd always pull into that donut shop. I can't remember the name now, but it was a donut shop at Tennessee and Lomas. And you'd get out of your car and say, Murph, tell him you're out talking with me. I go, okay, Bob. So, 87 PD, I'm made out with car one at Tennessee and Lomas, and there'd be just a 10-4. And we'd go inside, and we'd sit down, and we'd sit there and we'd talk about everything. Not sometimes a lot of police work, but the one thing you used to say is the best time you ever had on the department was riding a motorcycle. And we'd sit there and talk for however long you wanted. And you'd get to smoke your cigarette or two. And next thing you know, say, well, I guess it's time to head up to the mountains. So after about a half hour, 45 minutes or so, we'd shake hands and we'd go out and he'd take off. We'd say goodbye and I'd say, 87BD, I'm now 10-8. No one would say a word, my sergeant, lieutenant, or captain. So that's my one story there. That was your first term as a chief. Now, the second term as a chief was back into the 90s. And I used to park my motorcycle there by the police station up there where the motorcycle parking were. And there you were, outside sitting there smoking your cigarette. And the reason being is because they had rules then back in the 90s where they didn't have in the 70s, and you couldn't smoke in the building. So you'd sit out there and you'd say, hey Murph, sit out here and talk to me. I'd say, okay. So I'd call radio again. Hey, my number had changed at that time. I'd say, 561 PD, could you tell court that I'm gonna be late? I've got to take care of some official business with the chief. And they say 10-4. And I'd sit out there as long as he wanted. He'd smoke a cigarette or two, and we'd talk about everything, a lot of things outside the department, and how he used to like to ride motors and what's going on, this and that. And we'd have a real good time out there. And he'd get done that first or second cigarette, and he goes, well, I guess I gotta get back up to the office again. I'd say, okay, Bob. I said, we'll see you later, and take it easy.
Hi, my name is Nick Allred. I had the pleasure of working for Chief Stover twice. Once when I was a patrolman, and once when I was a DC. My first stories are when I was a patrolman, he was chief the first time. I always got called up to the chief's office because I was always accused of doing stuff wrong, but they never proved it. But I got my ass chewed out a lot. So the first go around with you, chief, wasn't that great. The second time was super. I have so many stories about us. I really couldn't tell them all, but I'll say a few of them. I remember one time when you used to want us to all go out to do our PT, and we had the little Filipino kid. I think his name was Gerald. We had to run around and do anything, and I remember we were doing sit-ups, and you told Gerald, just wait. So you got up from doing your sit-ups and lit up a cigarette, and I thought that little guy was going to go crazy. But he got over it, and we finished up. Another story is your first day as chief, the second time, you called Jim Emsing, myself, Elton, and Dave Ramirez in, and it only took about 5 seconds. You called us in, we sat down, you said, listen, I'm paying you SOB some good money to make decisions. If you can't, you let me know now and I'll get somebody who can. Get out of my office. I said, I can work for this guy. But we had so much fun. During the summer, all our softball games we had with different divisions. Of course, you always wanted to be the pitcher so you didn't have to run. And I've made all of us run. But it was a pleasure working for you. If you call me today to go to work, to go to war with you, I will. It was a pleasure working for you, annoying, and it was an honor.
Chief Stover, you're the man's man, the chief's chief. I don't even know where to start telling you how much I admire you and how much you meant to me in my life. You know, as you well know, I was a cub reporter and you were the chief, and I've always been a sucker for somebody in uniform, so I just thought you were amazing. And, you know, at the news conferences, sometimes you'd give the reporters hell, so it wasn't always a harmonious relationship, but I always thought that you were fair, and one of the things I admired about you was that you called him as you saw him, and that made for some good television and some great sound bites, too. So at one point, I thought you were so inspiring that I really wanted to be a police officer, so I was checking into it, figuring out what that would be, and I was young enough to still pull it off. I think I was like 22 at the time. But then it occurred to me that I really didn't have the courage to do it, that I could just picture some old lady would be calling saying that there was somebody creeping around her backyard or whatever, and I'd be like calling for backup. I'd be calling for backup for everything, I think, because I just didn't have the courage. So I stuck with reporting where I just had a pencil instead of a gun. I don't know if you'll remember this, but one time I had this really big story and I was about ready to break it, and it was an exclusive. And you called me into your office, and that's the kind of relationship we had. And I'm like, what do you need, Chief? And he's like, you can't go with this story. You're gonna ruin my operation. I mean, we've put a lot of time and energy in this, and you can't do it. Please don't do it. I mean, you couldn't order me not to, but you were appealing to my community senses. And so I didn't, but we had an agreement that when the time was right, you'd let me know so I could break the story. And we also had an agreement that since I was cooperating, you'd also give me another exclusive. So that worked out. I got a 2-for-1. Thanks, Chief. Just such a great guy. So important to me. Always just inspiring. And that went on for years. You know, when you walked in, people paid attention. There was also the time that you were gaming me. I was in your office and you had this button, if I recall correctly, underneath your desk. And you guys had this set up, but I'm sitting there and all of a sudden, boom, all these officers come swarming in, scared me to death, and you guys had a good laugh over that. Yeah, so you got that one on me. So anyway, Chief, I wish you the best. Simply put, I love you.
Hi, Chief Stover. It's Sharon Walton. I'm not even sure if you remember me, but I was a brand new attorney in 1993 when you were the Chief of Police. And I remember my very first chief staff meeting. I went in and sat and listened to all of you, and at the very end of the meeting, you looked around at everybody and you said, this new attorney we got, she worth a shit? And I was just about to raise my hand and let you go, I'm right here, when I realized you knew I was there the whole time. You were just messing with me. I didn't get the opportunity to work with you long, but I heard so many stories over the years. You made such an impact on the police department and on my career, and I admire you so much. I'm happy to be part of this. Thanks, Chief.
Hi, Chief. I have been here all morning listening to everybody's stories about you, but you should have heard the things they didn't share on tape. I wish they would have had the balls to say them. I told you what you meant to me privately last week. but I just want to thank you for promoting me to captain and for loving me. But I just want to say I love you more.
Chief, I'm going to share some stories that were sent to me by email for you. I was working, recruiting and training when the sheriff took office. I also held the chief steward position for the White Collar Union. Sheriff Stover was always available and straightforward. He called me Union Goon, and I mostly called him boss. He would quietly demand the truth about both my department duties and the union ones. I quickly respected his way and found it very easy to deal with him. Some problems occurred in warrants, and Sheriff Stover asked for my help. I have never been so honored. I retired in 2001, and Sheriff Bob Stover remains the sheriff I respect the most. He claimed to enjoy the job, and I sincerely hope he did. I will continue to pray for Bob Stover, a very special man. Cynthia McVeigh.
Retired Bernalillo County Deputy Adam Smith says, "Sir, it was an honor to have you at my academy graduation in 1989. You instilled great knowledge and work ethics in me. May God speed your recovery. You are in my prayers."
The stories of Bob Stover go back to when he was a detective in the juvenile division and I was the secretary. He had a special way of working with the kids. Later, when I was an officer and he was chief, he told me about a book he had been reading by James Herriot that he thought I would enjoy. And so I was introduced to one of the funniest book series. Of all creatures great and small, all things wise and wonderful, and God made them all, which I thoroughly enjoyed. I remember him telling me one day when he was chief that the police work he had enjoyed the most was working with the kids in the juvenile division. That was one of the things, among others, that made me decide that doing what I love doing the most, investigating cases, was more important than rank and fortune, because I knew God would take care of all of my needs if I had faith and trusted in Him. Gunny Vedder.
Don Daniel says, "Bob V. Stover, you are a good man, and were a professional, honest, and fair chief and sheriff. The Albuquerque Police Department and Bernalillo County Sheriff's Departments were in good hands during your long and successful career. They were both better departments due to your steady yet progressive style of leadership. I am proud to say that I had the honor and pleasure to have worked with you, Bob Stover. Wishing you the very best, Chief."
Bob isn't given enough credit for being a good, honest, and fair leader of police. Today there are no chiefs, only administrators, who are clueless as to what officers on the street face 24/7. Bob spoiled too many of us with his great leadership. Now, other chiefs just don't measure up. Please give Chief Stover a hug from me and Jerry's kids, and tell him thank you for being a really good man and a fine chief of the APD. Yolanda Klein.
Back in 1975, I was Bob's administrative aide. He and I were the only 34s that lived in the mountains, and sometimes other 34s would tease us for living way the heck out there. Who would want to live in the middle of nowhere? I snickered and would not tell them why. Regardless, one day, Bob's well pump quit, and the two of us took off to pull the pump. Not being familiar with wells, I did not know what I was in for. We pulled and pulled between 300 and 400 feet of pipe and cable until the pump finally came out. We laid it neatly all over the backyard in preparation for replacement. My time as the administrative aide was an honor that few 34s had the opportunity to participate in. As the assignment was only for 4 months, I stayed on for 6 months until the next rotation, being replaced eventually by Phil Chacone. As far as I'm concerned, Bob was the best chief the department ever had, truly being a cop's cop. Signed, Dick Porter. Chief Stover helped me become the police officer I was and saved my career at one time. I am extremely in his debt. My prayers are going out to God for his recovery, and my prayer warriors are also in prayer for him. God bless for a full recovery. Frank Lunsford. Dr. Pete DeVosto says, Chief Stover, you and L. Campbell gave me a start to my career, and I'll always be grateful. I will go on record as saying that you are the best boss I ever had in now my nearly 60 years of work. Bob and I shared a similar career start. He joined APD about 5 years before I did. We were patrolmen, sergeants, and lieutenants together, and then he became the chief of police in 1972. I was a young and inexperienced lieutenant in 1973 when he appointed me acting captain, then captain, and finally deputy chief, all within the span of about 10 months. My, he sure knew how to take risks. It was my great honor and privilege to serve him in the department as deputy chief for 4 years, then an assistant chief for 2 more years. During those years, Bob was my supervisor, my chief, and more importantly, my mentor and friend. He demonstrated to me and others his high moral courage and his commitment to the needs of the police department and its personnel. Small wonder that following his retirement, he served as the city of Albuquerque's chief administrator for a brief period, and was elected sheriff twice by a resounding vote. Bob Stover's leadership, friendship, and influence over the lives of many police officers and deputies will endure for many, many years. Signed, Lou Powell.
Bob, this is Joe Bowditch. I served under you for many years, and I kind of followed in your footsteps. I ran for sheriff, you ran for sheriff first, and you won, and then after you were through, I ran for sheriff. But I never caught you. I never did make chief of police. 2 weeks, I was interim chief of police, but that doesn't count. You were a great mentor, a great cop, and the thing I remember the most is you never forgot where your roots were. You never forgot that patrolman. You never forgot that person on the bottom and how they worked. I learned to be politically correct and speak that way from you. Instead of staying bull beep, I would say massive metal muffins and things like that. You were a true leader, and you were chief for many years, and I still wish you were there. Nobody surpassed you. We've had good chiefs, but you're the greatest. And I just want to tell you, God bless you, and hang in there, Bob. You can do it.
Bob, you probably won't remember this, but on April 8th, 1977, I found myself standing tall with 17 of my classmates at the graduation of the 44th Albuquerque Police Department cadet class. We raised our right hands, and we took an oath to support and defend the Constitution of the United States and the Constitution of the State of New Mexico from all enemies, foreign and domestic. And we embarked on our careers with the Albuquerque Police Department, serving under Chief Bob Stover. The impact you had on my career and those of my colleagues cannot be overstated. You were part of my formative years with the Albuquerque Police Department. Fast forward several years, and in the early 90s, in your second tour as the chief of the Albuquerque Police Department, I found myself as a lieutenant in the operations review section in your office, and I got to see you up close and personal. Your leadership style, your steady hand, your ability to keep the ship calm in rough seas was unbelievable, actually. Your ability to treat the janitor who cleaned your office and the mayor with the same dignity and respect was something to see. And I thank you for those things. And then finally, in June of 1994, I had the opportunity to take the baton from you when I was named as your replacement as chief of police. And I'll never forget the 30 minutes I spent in your office that day. The wisdom and the guidance that you parted to me will always be remembered. So on behalf of the citizens of the city of Albuquerque and the county of Bernalillo, and the men and women who served under your watches as our chief and our sheriff, thank you. You served with honor, courage, and commitment. But most importantly, I thank you for your friendship. God bless and Godspeed, Bob.
I think everybody has what I call a Bob Stover moment. In 1977, I'd been transferred to Albuquerque, and Bob Stover was the chief of the Albuquerque Police Department. I was with the New Mexico State Police, and I was working east of Albuquerque. It was before the interstate was even complete. There had been a pretty bad accident, and Chief Stover stopped to check on me to find out if everything was okay. And interestingly enough, I had one of those Bob Stover conversations. It went this way. I told him the predicament that I was in, and he looked at me and he said, "You know what, young man? Always do the right thing. You do the right thing and nobody can condemn you." And those words stuck with me for a long, long time. They're still in my heart today. And I just wanted to share that brief moment that really helped shape my career. So Bob, thank you. And we love you for all the work that you've done for the city, the county, and this state, and for law enforcement. Thank you.